So let me welcome our host for today, Sade Sellers. Sade, come on in.
Hello.
Hey, Sade.
Hi.
Welcome back.
I feel like I see you all the time. I know. And everyone on Twitter was like, when are you coming back? Are you coming back for the end of the year? And I'm like, yeah, we got one more. Yeah. So happy Final Draft allowed me to do this one because I really wanted everyone to enter 2021 just like more knowledgeable, having their tools ready so we can hit the ground running. And wow, this chat, Sade, are you seeing this chat box?
Yeah, it's amazing. People from all over the world.
I love it.
Well, I'm going to head out of here. Have a great panel, guys. This has been great. Enjoy.
All right, the boss is gone. Let's go. No, just kidding. Okay, you guys, welcome back. Thank you so much. I'm looking at the chat box and you're all over the world. This is so amazing. I really hope you take as much out of this as the work that we put into it. I have amazing panelists today. It is breaking in the business of screenwriting. So we are here to talk about business side that includes contracts, shopping agreements, optioning, difference between TV and film markets, all of those questions. I'm going to start off with a caveat. If you're looking for like how to get an agent, how to get a manager, how to find an attorney, all of my other panels, we've addressed those very delicately and very intricately. So please go check out the other panels on YouTube that I have hosted. We answer those questions about finding agents, finding managers. This is strictly for business stuff, for contracts and agreements. And Toni, who's our attorney, she's here to give her advice again. And all of us, we're just here to give our personal experience advice. We are not advising you personally. We're just telling you what happened to us and how we navigated through that. But I really do think everything we're talking about today is going to be very good information for you to take with you into 2021. So with no further ado, I want to introduce my panel of people. So when I say your name, take your mic and off and turn on your cameras. We have Anna and Mark Casadei, writer and producing married couple extraordinaire team.
Hello.
Thank you so much for being here. I'm so happy to have you.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you for inviting us. This is crazy. I'm watching the chat just like explode. And we got people from Ohio to Texas to Switzerland.
I saw Mexico go by.
It's nuts.
Oh, there's Australia.
So, hi, everyone.
Hi. And next, we also have attorney Toni Long of the Long Law Group. Hi, Toni.
Hi, good morning. Well, good morning from where I am. I'm seeing, like you guys, I'm seeing people from all over the world, Australia, Portugal. And this is insane. That's fantastic. Hello, everyone.
Amazing. Ireland, South Africa, so whatever.
Oh, Kenya. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. This is nutty, but Belize. I'm from Belize. Hi, where my family is. That's awesome. So if you guys have seen my our final draft panels that I host before, you know how it works. We're always gonna start off with an introduction to our panelists so you can know who they are. And then we are gonna dive right in and answer your questions. So if you're not using that Q&A box, you should use that Q&A box. There are some questions that have been pre-submitted that I've already picked a few that will get us started. So we hopefully, if you hear one of those, you won't ask the same questions, but we're here for you. We want to service you. We don't want to make this a panel of just us talking at you. We want to answer your questions. You came here, you're from all over the world. You're up at 2 a.m., 3 a.m. So we want to make sure we're answering your questions. So ask them and I can get you the answers. But first we're going to start with an introduction so you know who everyone is. So Mark and Anna, please introduce yourselves to our people.
Hi, I'm Mark Casadei, and I've been writing partners with Anna now. We are a married couple. We've been working together since around 2007, 2008.
We can't remember.
It's been a while, but originally met in Alaska. I'm a retired U.S. Air Force sergeant, and during that time I went into screenwriting and filmmaking, and it's a passion of mine. I loved it. And I was lucky enough to find the actual better half of the screenwriting. And we've been doing it and going crazy ever since.
Well, that's like half my story. So, I helped a friend do an indie in 2005, an indie feature. And I got first AD credit for that. And I realized how much I love the screenwriting. So I went to UCLA online because I was living in Alaska and wrote a couple scripts through there. And I met Mark in, like you said, 2007, 2008, and we've been basically writing together ever since. So
that's it, short and sweet.
Yeah.
Awesome. And you're the owner of how many bunnies?
Five.
Yeah, we have five crazy rabbits.
Five rabbits.
We're allergic to cats and dogs, so the rabbits are the only thing we're not allergic to. So yeah. Sorry.
Great. And maybe they'll make an appearance later on.
We might have one, yes.
Toni, please introduce yourself to our lovely fan group here.
Okay, awesome. Well, hello, everyone. I'm seeing all these people from all over the place. I'm an entertainment transactional and business transactional attorney here in Pasadena. So I've seen a couple people logging on from Pasadena. So hello to my fellow Pasadenians, I guess is what it is. I'm Bruin, UCLA School of Law, and a Cardinal Stanford undergrad. And I've been practicing law now, I'm almost 20 years. So yeah, working on films as production counsel, working with independent writers, producers, directors, you name it, on all their contracts and business and legal needs across the board.
Awesome. And I met Toni online, I think.
Was it earlier this year or last year? You were looking for representation and we started talking. So then I invited you to my group.
Yes. And she runs can we mention the group? I don't know.
I mean, it's basically a group of people who I know in the industry, women of color, Black women in the industry. And once we went on lockdown, I basically said, you know, here's a great way for all of us to get together and me not have to plan these social events all over LA to get people from the West Side, people from the Valley. Like you have to plan things in like three or four different locations in order to capture everybody. And so since we're on lockdown, it's like, okay, let's do this via Zoom and let's make it a networking happy hour so that people can have an opportunity to meet each other and there's no pressure. There's, you know, just getting to know each other. And so it's a very informal group and Sade has been coming and a great participant and yeah.
I try to make it, I have no excuse. Most times it's just like Grey's Anatomy reruns are on. I miss it. But I love the group. It is really nice since I'm quarantining alone to have like a set schedule of people I can talk to at a certain time. Yeah. So those are our panelists, you guys. Okay, so we did our intros. I'm gonna start us off with the number one question that's on everyone's mind. But to reiterate again, in case you're joining in later, if you're here to ask questions about agents, managers, and copywriting even, we have talked about those in long discussion in my previous panels, which are on, I didn't tell you where to find them, Final Draft's YouTube, the series Breaking In. And if it says Breaking In featuring Sade Sellers, you can guarantee we definitely talk about agents and managers and copywriting. So please go check out those videos because we're here to talk about like other business stuff. And I want to answer all the business questions. So the first one I want to start off is to Toni, because we were talking about this before we started the panel. When is the appropriate time for someone to seek an attorney, a screenwriter?
Yeah, I get that all the time. And I, you know, here's what I will tell you as a screenwriter, or really anyone in the industry. If someone puts a contract in front of you and says, sign it, call an attorney. Do not sign it. It's infinitely easier for us to navigate through the issues on the front end, and it's less expensive for you and it's less time consuming than to have what I have a lot of times, which is someone has signed a contract that they didn't understand. The other party starts explaining what their obligations are under that contract and the person didn't realize they had certain obligations or that they weren't getting the rights they thought they were getting. And so I get a call like, can you get me out of this contract? Well, it will depend on the terms of the contract and what you agree to. So it's always better to know beforehand. You want to have informed consent, right? It's kind of like when you go to the doctor. Know beforehand what you're signing. And I know a lot of people, well, I can't afford an attorney. How do I find an attorney? Listen, you find an attorney these days the same way you find anyone. I cannot tell you how many people, like I found you because I typed in certain search terms to Google and you popped up and I did my due diligence and called you. Some of us will do free initial consultation. Some of us won't. But if it's $300 or what have you to talk to an attorney for 30 minutes or an hour to get some basic questions answered. What it will cost you to get someone to get you out of that contract is multiples of that 300, like multiply that 300 by 10 at least. So don't sign anything if you don't understand what you're signing. As a writer, when should you hire me? Yeah, generally before you sign anything, before you commit yourself. If someone is trying to get you to write something and not pay you, you know, call an attorney. that's usually not a good deal for you. The writers can definitely speak to that, because I don't know a single writer who has not had that happen to them.
Yeah, and that actually leads me over to Mark and Anna. As writers and producers, I'm sure you've seen many, many deals come across your area, but the one question that was asked from Nathan, I didn't see a last name, but Nathan, he pre-submitted this question, and I really think it's a good grounding question to get us started. Can you explain, either Mark or Anna, actually, let's start with Mark. I think Mark will have the answer to this. Can you give the difference between a shopping agreement and an option? Because I feel like a lot of people get that mixed up.
Yeah, you know, that's kind of tricky too, because in some companies it almost means the same thing. Mm-hmm. And when you say, you know, they want to option the script so they can shop it. And a lot of time that option has a time limit to it. It has a period of, I want to option the script for you. And what they're actually doing, whether it's an option agreement or a shopping agreement, and I think Toni can probably agree to this too, what they're actually doing is they're taking custody of that idea and or screenplay to allow you basically no hands-on from this point on. They want to be the sole person to be able to bring it to the industry, to go ahead and find a home for it with another production company, maybe bring other producers on and start kind of getting a feel of what the market is for that screenplay. The problem is that depending on the level of that production company, whether it's a small, tiny, independent production company or a big studio, it's the amount they're willing to option it for you. I've seen people come to us and go, we're going to option your screenplay for a dollar. And I'm like, okay, you're going to do what for a dollar? No, you're not. I put a lot of hard work in that. We put a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. Our time and value is worth more than that. Because what you're saying is, if I do a 6-month option agreement for a dollar, you can't do anything with that screenplay for the entire 6 months, which means if Joe producer comes by, who's a more accomplished producer and more successful, you can't pitch that screenplay to him because you've already signed an option agreement saying you would not do exactly that.
And it does get complicated depending on who you go to. And in that case, Toni, when you do get a shopping or option agreement across your desk, what's the first thing you're looking for as an attorney? Or it's the first red flag that you'll notice?
One of the things I do when these contracts come to me is I have a call with the client to see what their understanding is of what's in this agreement, because I want them to tell me this is what I agree to or think I'm agreeing to with this person. And that way I can go through and say, well, actually, that's not what's in here, or you're correct. And these are, you know, Mark touched on one of the first things that I look at, and that's alarming to me, is if someone wants to take your project off the market and have it for an exclusive period for a very low fee. A dollar option does you no good at all. And I like to see producers who are going to option your project have some skin in the game. So if you want to take my client's project off the market for 6 months, 18 months, or whatever, then you've got to pay for that. And you should pay, you know, a sum that, you know, it's negotiable. There's no set fee that an option has to be, but it should be something that represents that you're serious as a producer about taking this project out. Because if I get something for a dollar, how hard am I going to really work to get that project made? Now, if I spent $1,000 or $2,000, then yeah, I'm going to start pounding the pavement to try and find someone to make this project. So when I see those agreements, the first red flags will be what the payment is if it's too low. The second red flag will be the term. How long do they want to option the project? Someone sent a client of mine a shopping agreement. It wasn't even a full-fledged option. And they wanted to essentially take the project off the market for a total of 36 months. The first option period was 18 months, and then they had an ability to re-up it for another 18. And I said, absolutely not. Not for what you're willing to pay. That's 3 years that my client will not be able to shop this project to anyone else. So that's what you have to think about when someone comes to you with a shopping agreement or an option agreement.
And thank you so much for answering that question, because especially during the pandemic, there are a lot of people trying to make deals that include, like, nothing can happen until we're out of the pandemic, and I've seen it, and it's not great. I also want to remind everyone, I am looking at the chat box, but I'm mostly picking the questions from the Q&A box, and so it's different. So ask your questions in the Q&A box so I can answer them, but there are some good questions in the chat, so I'm going to try to pull from both. But I do want to answer, ask this question from Maureen O'Grady, because I think this is important, especially with everything that's going on in the WGA, if some of you are in it, or even if you're non-union, just to know. I'm going to pitch it to Anna. Can agents effectively review contracts? And then I actually want to hear Toni's opinion on that too.
Okay, we don't have an agent. We have a manager. And our manager will look things over, and you know, I'm a former paralegal, so I have a good idea, but you know, we still have an attorney look everything over, and that's through our manager. Our manager gets it to his attorney, and so I don't know. I can't speak to agents.
Toni?
Technically speaking, yeah, your agent is going to look at your contract, but generally speaking, your agent and your manager are looking at your contract for very different reasons. They're looking at the business terms. They want to make sure the payment is what, you know, is good for you. The payment terms are good for you. For example, if you're a WGA writer, there are certain ways that payment has to work. And so if that's not in there, they will pick up on that very quickly. I have clients who have agents and or managers, and I still get the contracts as well, because there are certain legal issues that they may not be, not so much attuned to, but it's just not on their radar, or it's not front of mind for them, that I will look for. And we all work together to make sure that our clients' interests are protected. So it's good to have kind of both on your team.
Yeah. And then as we're still talking about money and contracts, this question came from, and they're answering, they're so fast, and now I can't, oh, here it is, from Kevin Shaw. Toni, what is a fair option price? It's not a dollar, but what? I know that's a very broad question.
Yeah, I mean, that really is, it's a very broad question. It's going to depend on a lot of factors, but what I would tell you is you should talk to, before you accept payment for an option on your screenplay, talk to other writers and see what they're being offered. If you don't have an attorney, because the range really varies. If you are an established writer, that option price is going to be significantly higher. No established writer is giving away a screenplay for a couple hundred bucks. That's going to be possibly in the thousands, maybe even the tens of thousands, depending on how established you are. If you're a new writer, don't expect to get a $10,000 option unless the screenplay is so hot and it's being, you know, everyone wants it. And so you're receiving multiple offers to option the screenplay. But yeah, it's really going to depend. It's across the board. But think about also the person who is optioning your screenplay. What is their track record? I had a client who came to me because this first time producer wanted to option his screenplay, and he wanted to generally we tie the purchase price to the budget in some deals. And the option was really low, and the option was for a very long period of time. And given the nature of the screenplay, I had serious reservations about whether or not this first time producer could get a period piece that's set in multiple foreign locations made. I certainly had questions about whether or not he could get it made for what he had pegged as being the budget. And I was like, I don't know what universe he's living in, but I've never seen a period piece shot in like five or six different international locations made for what he was talking about. So I said, absolutely not. When you're asking me before, what are some red flags? Those are some red flags right there.
Mark, did you, I thought I saw you raise your hand a little bit.
Well, yeah. Well, I don't know if I raised my hand, but yeah, I wanted to piggyback off of Toni a little bit. You know, when you're a brand new writer starting out, and even in our case, our first option agreement that we felt was respectable, you know, it was at the lower end. And like Toni said, you know, you have to have a track record. You can't go in as a new writer and say, I want $15,000 or I'm not talking to you. Well, you're going to be pegged as hard, difficult to work with. You kind of have to do a give and take a little bit and understand that, you know, I'm willing to go to the low end because this is going to give me an opportunity as a brand new writer to start building my portfolio of success. And if you're not willing to kind of chew a little bit off of this end or, you know, ask for a little bit later on this end, you won't get far. What you do get far is finding a middle ground that you can be comfortable with, because it is ultimately in the end about your comfort level. Mm-hmm. If you're willing to say, you know what, okay, you know, $500, it's fine. It's just a little indie project. Why not? Let me do it. My name's on it. It'll get out there. And then I can say, hey, look, I did this feature film indie project. Well, now as you go to your next indie producer and so on, and you start building these films up, your price also goes up because now you have experience just like in any other job. The more experience you have, the more valuable you are. So always remember, know your worth. It's the one thing that we always say to writers, understand your worth at any given point in your career.
And to piggyback off of that, Toni, would you, because there's a lot of, I assume most of the people in this panel are non-union and mainly unrepresented. Would you, at your advice, Kamala Lane, who asked us in the chat box, can an unknown writer, she said, ask for WJ minimum. I want to pitch it. Can they use the WJ minimum as kind of like a starting point? And then maybe down from there, if you're unknown.
Yeah, I mean, you can certainly use the WJ minimums as a guideline, but do understand that, you know, a sophisticated producer on the other side, provided they are, is going to say, you're not a member of the WGA, so no. If you're not a member of the WGA, it gives you an idea in terms of what the floor is in the industry. But do understand that your floor for you as a non-WGA member is going to be a little bit lower. I saw in the chat that someone said, you know, they sold their first screenplay for $1,500. I mean, hey, that's fine if that's what you want to do. But what I would tell you is, there's a value to your time and the time that you spend and the effort that you put in writing. One of the problems I have with this industry is we treat writers as if they are interchangeable, throwaway commodities. Yeah. There would be no television series for you to watch, movie for you to see, play for you to sit in the audience to view, but for someone picking up a pen or a laptop and writing down an idea. The way this industry treats writers, in my opinion, is shameful. And I say that as someone who represents a lot of writers. And I say that as someone who represents producers who then has to negotiate with writers, where I take kind of an opposite approach, you know.
Yeah.
It's what we lawyers do. We can fight on both sides of the field. But listen, if you don't advocate for yourself and advocate for your value, someone is going to basically peg that value for you. So if someone says, hey, I'll give you $1 for your screenplay to option your screenplay for 12 months and you accept that, you've basically just put a value on yourself and on your product. Someone spending 30 days or 45 days writing a screenplay, if you're writing 8 hours a day, multiply that by the minimum wage, right? And see what you should be getting. So if you got $1,500 and you worked 30 days and there was 8 hours a day, that's not a living wage for you. And writing is hard. Listen, I don't write. It's not my thing. I've tried. I did some stuff in undergrad. I'm not good at it, but I greatly appreciate when I read a good screenplay or a great novel, I greatly appreciate the time and effort that went into creating that.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I could talk about that part.
No,
that'd be a whole other panel. How do we love writers?
That's a whole different final draft.
We'll do another one, part two, because we're not, and again, we're going to try to answer as many questions as we can, you guys, but there might be a part two next year because there's just a lot to go through. I do want to share very quickly my experience, very quickly, so we can just be transparent. I've had a lot of success. I'm non-union and I've had a lot of success just with those little deals like, oh, can you do this for X amount? I will say a reputable network and production company, and I won't say their name because I have good feelings about them. I just don't want to inundate them with any messages that you might send later. My first option script, I got paid $10K for it. It was based off an IP of their own. It came in installments, which we're going to talk about soon. And it sounded like a good deal to me, but they also worked in a city that is non-union and it is a right to work state. Mm-hmm. So it was a lower end deal because of where they were shooting and where the company is based in. I think we all know what city that is. I don't have to say it out loud. But that was my first deal. And I will say it hasn't happened since. I'm trying to get back there. But what it's taught me is that now I have a base for myself. I'm like, well, this company paid that. I'm not going below that. That was 3 years ago. So I should now get a little bit more than that. So if that helps anyone, great. If it doesn't help anyone, I'm sorry I shared the story. Marissa Stanbeck, if they sell an option, if I sell the option, what happens next? Is the writers still hands-on, Mark?
Yeah. So the writers are hands out. So once that option agreement takes place.
Well, yeah, it all depends on your contract,
right?
But usually, yes, the writer is kept on.
Right. Yeah. The writer is kept on. Again, the one thing you really have to understand is that there is no black and white that this happens every single time during a deal or every single time with a production company. Again, it depends on the company. Each company has their own way of doing business. Each producer has their own way of doing business. So I'll take an example of one of our recent option agreements. Again, like Sade, I won't say the actual company's name, but mm-hmm. we actually love this company. We love working with them. This is our second movie with them. And we are optioned with them again. And our first option with them, we were very involved. We went into development after our option agreement was in place and after the contract was signed. We were the writers that actually developed the script with them. So we got all their notes. We got all their requirements that they wanted for the script and the story. And we went back and forth, about 7-8 drafts. And then we finally hit that final draft mark where they were absolutely happy with. And now we pull back at that point because now the option agreement is in place and now they're shopping it around. So it depends. There are some times where they shop it around first before you even get a chance to work on anything just so they can test the market and see if the idea is going to stick. Mm-hmm. Again, it's all very fluid. It's all very depending on that company.
And this also goes to a question that Kate O'Haron had asked, and we're going to reiterate this one last time. If a producer comes to you and wants to either option or shop agreement, which is better? And again, that depends on a lot of things, but Kate, just what Mark was saying, there is the slight differences, because I used to work at a production company and we did shop a TV show and we took it all across the city to all different networks and studios. And that was a part of our agreement that we would go to then attach using our connections, a studio or a network to get that show made. And unfortunately, as great as the show is, as much as I believe in the show, no one bought it. And then the agreement ended and it went back to the writers. So it definitely just depends, like Mark is saying, on who the company is, who their connections are. And obviously check with your attorney about that, which is a better option.
Can I add something to that really quickly? Because one of the major differences that I see with shopping agreements versus option agreements is certainly the ones that I draft. The option agreements will pretty much lay out your terms, like fully, if someone options this screenplay, what are you going to be paid? What's your credit going to be? Are they optioning for film, television, streaming, what have you? If I'm representing the producer, obviously we want to option that screenplay across the board for all media and platforms. And then we try to set forth the terms. Because here's the deal, if someone gives you an option agreement and there are no payment terms in there and they come back to you to exercise that option, you have them over a barrel. Because at that point, you know, somebody wants that screenplay. Well, how much are you going to pay me? Well, we want to pay you $5,000. oh, no. Yeah. You're going to pay me a lot more because I know you have a potential buyer. I mean, don't, you know, get crazy and shoot yourself in the foot. Yeah. But I've seen that as well, where someone doesn't understand the person who's on the other side, doesn't understand the deal, and they do an option without any payment, without a purchase price, and you get raked over the coals. With a shopping agreement in that scenario, what happens is that company is going to take that screenplay out. They're going to try and attach in a production company, maybe a known director, talent or something. And then whoever buys it will do a deal with you to buy that or to option that screenplay. And that's when those terms will be worked out at that point.
It's a separate deal, which I want everyone to understand. So for example, if we option, if I'm a production company and I shop, get a shopping agreement for Toni's script, I take it to FX, FX buys it. FX is not dealing with both of us because we're not a team. They're going to have their deal with you and they're going to have their deal with me as a producer.
That's
important to know because you may think you're on the same page in this team with this production company. They're going to take care of their own deal. You need to take care of your deals.
Yeah. And the agreements will usually say that. I mean, we put that in our shopping agreements all the time that, you know, you're not going to do anything that frustrates this deal. All the negotiations have to be done in good faith. If you're the writer, you're not going to hold this up by asking for something completely unreasonable. It's going to be in line with, you know, industry norms and quote unquote precedent. So
now, Mark, I want to ask, Anna, I want to ask you this question. It's from Julia Wells, because it's a good question I never really thought about before. Fellowships. She applies to TV fellowships and they require you to sign a contract, but there's no way to negotiate this. Like, how do you navigate that? How do you know when you're signing your life away and when you don't? Do you have time to give an attorney a copy of a fellowship agreement that they can't even negotiate?
Right. Yeah,
those are pretty solid.
Those are, you know, we personally don't do fellowships. We've never had fellowships. You're asking me all the hard questions. But you know, if you can get an attorney to read it, you know, great. But how do you navigate it? I mean, you have to just take it in good faith. I don't think something like Imagine Impact is going to screw you over. You know, they're an established, you need to make sure that it's an established fellowship and it's an established thing. That's what I would be most wary of.
One of the things about the fellowships is that, and this is in a good way, look, the fellowships are established large production companies that have a pipeline of success doing these programs. The programs themselves are not set up to throw you for a loop, to steal your idea or anything like that. They're trying to find new talent to bring into their pipeline so they can staff them on shows, so they can bring in a much larger pool. And most of those fellowships are pretty much cut and dry. If we actually look at the terms of those fellowships, I mean, they're not 67 page documents you have to decipher with a super decoder ring that you get in the mail. They're pretty straightforward. It says you're going to be doing this for this amount of time. If we develop this with you, it will become the property of Disney Plus. And you know, if you win or get selected, you'll be staffed on the show. If it's one of those things where you do have to take that leap of faith and work on it, because what it does do, and if you get in a fellowship, which I think is wonderful, the experience that you gain from that is just unprecedented. And I think it's a wonderful thing. And I think if you have the time and talent to do it, by all means, do it.
Toni, any feedback about fellowship or competitions in general where you really can't negotiate?
I mean, I had a client send their contract to me, and it's not so much to review it, even though it can't be negotiated. It's really so that that person, that writer, knew exactly what they were getting themselves into. And so I reviewed the contract and gave them a summary and said, okay, here's what you're giving up. Here's what you're going to get. Is it worth it to you to do this? Some of the fellowships are, there are a lot of writing competitions out there. Some of them are not legitimate. And what I mean by that is, it's basically a means for people to get your work and either take it from you in some kind of way based on what you've agreed to in a contract, or exploit it without your knowledge and without paying you. So it's better to, like I said before, spend a little time and money up front. If you're thinking of doing this, do your homework and make sure that the competition is legitimate before you sign. You could potentially sign away your rights to your own IP. Now, if push comes to shove and a lawsuit has to be filed, can you get those rights back? Sure. But a lawsuit costs a lot of time, takes a lot of time and costs a lot of money. And so it becomes a point of diminishing returns at that stage. Yeah. And so it's better to do things right on the front end than trying to correct them on the back end.
And my advice, just as the writing tip when it comes to fellowships or competitions at all, I've learned it's best to write for that competition, for that fellowship, rather than giving away something that you've worked on that's separate, if that makes sense. So if you have a baby, a script that you really love, I would not give that. My advice, for it works for me, is not to give that to the first fellowship or something, because I've seen it happen. People win competitions, they go, damn it, I did not want this baby of mine to be with this company or whatever, whatever. So anytime I enter a competition or a fellowship, I read the specs, the scope, and I write in particular for what their guidelines are rather than pulling out something. So I know I'm particularly writing for that competition. And if it doesn't win that competition, great, I can use it someplace else, but I'm not giving them my like favorite newborn baby that if good thing I do win, I don't, you know, and it doesn't work out. If that makes sense. That, Mark, do you find that? Well, you never did competitions, you lucky little.
We have done competitions.
Okay.
Just not fellowships.
Just not fellowships.
Yeah, competitions is a whole different animal for sure.
I want to answer this question from Sarah Barr, and I'll give it to you, Anna, and I promise it's not tricky. Because I do think this is important. So let's split the baby in half. Let's talk about features real quick, and then we can talk about TV. Can you go through the steps from writing, then what's next between writing and making the movie? Because I know you have experience with this. And I know it's different for everyone, but just in general, what after the script is done, and let's say it's optioned, then like, what are the steps to get to the movie?
Okay. So yeah, we run our script through a reader several times to make sure that it's polished before we send it out. And then we have a manager that we use, and he gets it to people for us. And we will sometimes go, hey, you know, we think this would be a really good fit for A24, or this would be a good fit for Blumhouse. And, you know, we'll work with them, with our manager, to get it to the people that we wanted to get it to. And he knows other people that we don't know that he works to get it to. And then after that, we do pitches, sometimes visual pitches, sometimes it's just writing a one sheet or whatever it is to get them interested. And then if it gets picked up, then we start going into production, and it's like rewrites. Like we're doing rewrites on a couple of different projects right now. And then after that, once everybody's okay with it, they start attaching talent. And then you'll have to rewrite it because they want to bring on the star, and that the part is too small, and it's a lot of rewrites. And but it's totally worth it.
the important thing to remember that once you're done with that script, and from the time the script is in its final draft form to the actual movie where it gets the first day of principal photography, there's a lot of things that have to happen during that time frame. And as a writer, you kind of sit back at that point because you let the producers now sink their teeth into it. Now they start worrying about time frames, shooting schedules, talent that has to be attached, where they're actually going to film this, the director attachment. All of these moving parts from point A to point B may cause the script to change. The script is really never until its final form until it's actually released.
Right. You have one scene at this coffee shop. Could we do it in this other place instead? That way we save on locations. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that, you know, really gets changed from your original version to the final version. But the whole point is that everybody's trying to make a good film. And so if you remember that while you're doing it, that's the important thing.
Yeah, I read a quote from a screenwriter, I believe the screenwriter of 50 First Dates, because I was watching it last night. And the interviewer asked him, like, how do you know when the script's done? He goes, a good writer knows the script is never done.
Yeah, that's 100% true. As a matter of fact, we had a certain project one time where we had to rewrite the script because in post they had to redo the ADR and the audio on it, but they wanted to change the lines. So that final version of that final script had to be changed again. And here we are, it's already been filmed. And it's been 4 months after we got done filming that they brought the actor back in. We changed the ADR, which changed the script in its final format before it finally got locked and closed. So It takes a while. It goes on for sure. It's
you
never done.
It's a hard industry. All of you people here, go back. No, I'm just kidding. Like, it's a hard industry though. Toni, this question is from James Wade. And I really like these questions. I want to start shifting into these a little more. What is the best approach to option an older magazine article or a book that hasn't been published yet?
Yeah, someone else in the Q&A asked something very similar, that they'd written a screenplay based on a book that they didn't have the rights to. So what I can tell you is you have to get the rights from the copyright holder of the article to base a screenplay on that article. You're creating a derivative work. The original copyright holder has all the rights to create derivative works from their content, basically from their IP, and they can give you the rights to do that. Now, can you do it? Of course you can do it. You know, you can also, you know, pull your own teeth. That doesn't make it a good idea. So there's a process by which you can do it where you would legitimately be able to take that project out and shop it and someone will buy it from you. So if you are looking at a magazine article, you contact the magazine or the writer of the article and see if they have the rights to that article. And then you option those rights from that writer or the publisher, if it's a book. And
or for rep, you gotta get it from the reps.
if the person is repped, good luck. You have to go through the reps and try and secure the rights there. And then you would basically be optioning something from them, or buying the rights outright. A lot of people buy the rights to magazine articles, news articles outright to create content for them, write a screenplay or a series or what have you. And that's how a lot of content is being created right now. You think about all the graphic novels that are being, you know, turned into feature films or television series.
Podcasts and
things that podcasts are very hot right now because we are stuck, you know, indoors. It's very easy to create a podcast, whereas it's very challenging to go shoot a film. It's not impossible. We've had films in production this year. But it is more difficult. So yeah, you have to talk to the underlying rights holder of that IP if you're going to create something based on that IP. And that in and of itself, going into that whole process is a whole nother.
The whole other thing. Quick story, because I've been through this process. Early in quarantine, I found a book that I loved. It was 5 years old. I went to the writer's website. She had contact information. I contacted the writer. She was repped by WME. Oh my God, damn it. So then she put me in touch with her agent and it took months, but and it didn't work out. But the long story short is that you actually have to go find it. You have to follow the breadcrumbs. If you, most of these writers have websites, they have contact. Who's your agents, who's your managers? I'm interested in the book. Down the line, I will say the best source of material if you are looking to option something is the Amazon unpublished like writers list, like people who self-publish, the self-published Amazon list. People who are just publishing their own novels for their home, it's the best unhidden gems because most of the times they're not repped and they would really much like to talk to you personally one-on-one. And I found the best luck just as a producer finding good option material on the unpublished list, self-published list on Amazon. That's my little tip. Mark from Jackie Mayer, is there a non-confrontational way to say that I want to sell my script, but I want to remain on the project, not just sell and walk away? Because I know you're a writer and producer. So what's your tips about that?
One of the biggest things, especially with new writers, is they want to be able to say, oh, I want to be able to come in and produce. And the very first question that they're going to ask you is, good, what's your experience? And then the first thing they do is go, I don't quite have any. So you got to be very careful with that. And as a first-time writer coming on board, it's going to be very hard for you to come in and say, I want to be able to produce this if you've never done anything before, or you don't have a history that you can actually relate to for that production company. What you can do though, is you may not be able to come on as a producer, but you can say, I want to be involved in the process of this project because this is my baby, this is my IP, and I want to continue to have some type of involvement to where I can have a creative influence on it. And there are some companies that are willing to work with you and go, you know, well, you know, you're going to be here as the writer, we will talk with you. We will continue to conference with you and make sure that the idea stays intact and in solid. For us, you know, one of our very larger deals is folks have heard about The Benefactor, a horror film starring Malcolm McDowell. We're coming on as producers. And one of the reasons why we're able to come on as producers with our manager with that is because we had the experience on the business side to actually talk to. And that was important to be able to go to another company and say, we understand the filmmaking process. We've done, you know, a half a dozen or so short films. We've distributed this, you know, we have, we had directing a few projects under our belt. So we understood the business as a whole, which they felt very comfortable bringing us on as, you know, in a producing capacity at that point. So if that kind of answers that question.
I would like to add really quick, if it's your first script and you want to have your fingers on it because it's your first script, you need to write another script and you need to learn how to be able to make these scripts and make these movies and make these shorts and get your work out there so you can learn to not hold everything so precious. And we have certain scripts that we really want to be attached to. You know, The Benefactor is one of them. We have a pilot called Death Takes a Holiday. Like, we would want to be involved in that. And if we couldn't be involved in that, then we need to find another company that would let us. But we have, you know, 10 other scripts that you can buy outright and
they can have.
Someone else can have it.
Have, sure, get out of here.
That's so important to note. And for everyone, and I want to pitch this to Toni too, because in terms of being a producer and a writer, when you know you have a script, should you automatically attach your production company to it as a little loophole to get you connected? Or is that, when do you know as a writer that you can start creating your own production company? Is basically the answer, the question I'm trying to answer for people.
Well, I mean, I think you need to, you know, basically have something that you've sold. I mean, because starting up a production company is going, there's costs associated with that. You know, setting up an LLC or an S Corp here in California, you're looking at the legal fees to do it. And California charges you $800 a year minimum for the privilege of having a corporate entity here. So it really is going to depend. It's not the answer a lot of people like, but it depends as to, you know, where you are in your career, how established you are, how much money you're making, whether or not it's advisable to even have a production company or a loan out company to run your projects through. Can you do an end around and attach your production company that way? I mean, people are sophisticated enough that that's kind of, you know, transparent, so maybe not. But I think if you're a writer and you want to remain connected to the project, here's what I can tell you that's very rare unless you are a very established writer. When I'm on the other side, repping producers or directors and working, trying to get content from writers, we don't generally want the writers involved beyond us getting their screenplay because, and we certainly don't give the writers any say-so over what happens after we option their screenplay. And the reason for that is we cannot have a writer who gets really attached to their baby holding up our project because they don't want to see something changed. Now, notwithstanding my earlier commentary about how important writers are very important, but when it's time to start making a movie, I agree with Anna and Mark, you've got to let that one go. And so if it's something that's so precious to you that you don't want anything changed, no one can, you know, redot an I or recross a T, you know, then don't sell it. Don't give it to anyone else.
And don't attach your production company to it if you can't actually execute.
Yeah, exactly.
Just because you have a cool little LLC, and people are going to look at that and go, but you've never done anything. And putting a name to it, it's unprofessional to do so. Always back up what you put out there is basically the main goal here.
Yes. And let's see, this is for Toni as well, because I think it's a very cute question. This is from anonymous attendee, and cute in the sense that, oh, it's so sweet and you'll see. How long does paperwork process typically take? I had producers saying he was sending an option to legal. That was 2 weeks ago. Should I start worrying? Oh, how sweet. Not laughing, laughing at you. At you, we're laughing.
We're not laughing. I mean, that is a very sweet question. And listen, when I work with new writers and new creatives who've never gone through a process before, they start to get worried if someone doesn't respond to them in like 2 or 3 days. And I just laugh. And I'm like, here's what I can tell you about this industry. It's hurry up and do nothing.
Yep.
Right. So when someone needs something from you, hurry, come on, I need it, I need it, I need it. And then when it's time for them to give you something, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 2 months, 5 months, 6 months later, you know, I've worked on projects where it took us months to even negotiate an option agreement to get it signed. And then when you're fortunate enough to have that happen and get a film made, I just worked with a client on getting the distribution agreement done. And that took 6 months to get that agreement done.
So,
So it really is going to depend. Just be patient is what I will tell you. Be patient with the process. Know that simply because you haven't heard from someone in a couple of weeks, that's fine. Also, we're in the holidays. This industry typically shuts down. Yeah, they shut down starting generally around this coming Monday.
Yep.
And then they don't open back up until the end of January because of all the festivals and various holidays that are happening and people taking vacations and what
even
have
in COVID, y'all, it does not change when people
it's still happening.
They want to go on vacation. Even
I've already put in my email that I'm out.
Which is why, in Final Draft, like, we got to do it. I was like, we got to do it before December 14th because no one is going to be working. Everyone, don't worry. I've dealt with, like I told you, I was talking to someone earlier in quarantine about her book deal. It didn't work out, but that was close to 6 months of going back and forth with emails because that's what happens. And you have to remember, you're not the only project. You're not the only project. Yes. They're dealing with
that's huge.
More. So very sweet question. We're not making fun of you. Please don't take it personally. It's just so sweet. Cause I've been so jaded by 10 years now. I'm like, if someone doesn't answers me within a month, I'm shocked. Like, this is amazing. This one is for me. It's a Sade from Dana Hughes. Many people think that you have to move to LA, New York, Atlanta, major cities to be noticed. Do you think that's true? I'm in Lansing, Michigan, your hometown. Curious on your thoughts.
We're from New York.
Yeah. But not New York City.
And we've done our whole career from New York. So anyone who says you have to live in LA.
I did most of my career from Alaska.
You know, if you want to write for TV, that's different because that is a completely different criteria that, you kind of do have to be in LA for that. But feature film, absolutely not.
Yeah. And not to mention now with COVID and the virtual rooms, I don't know how that's going to change our landscape. I hope it opens it up. Actually, I would love to know that someone from my hometown didn't have to, like I did at 19, give up her whole life to move to LA to write for TV, that they could do it from their hometown. We'll see. But no, I did a lot of work before I moved to LA, but that was 10 years ago. I think now you guys, you know, we have Zoom, we're on Zoom, we have Twitter, we have so much. You don't have to be in LA and you don't want to come here right now if the numbers are horrible here. So stay safe in your house. The best thing about being a writer, everyone should know this, all the participants, is that you can write wherever is the best. You can take your work with you. You can be on the beach and write. You can visit your family on holiday vacation and write. Like, it's amazing. So
we got a bunny sighting.
Bunnies.
we wanted to at least bring one out before it closed because everyone kept bugging us. So here's Snowflake.
Yeah. I just want to clarify, it's not on, I'm sorry, I kept saying it wrong. Not the unpublished list on Amazon, it's self-published list on Amazon. So if you just Google self-published Amazon, you'll see tons of novelists who are just putting their books out there and hoping someone sees it. And that someone could be you, and you could take that and translate that in the script. Now you have a piece of IP, which is much more lucrative, honestly, if we're talking about features and, you know.
That is a really great idea. That's a really great idea.
Okay, so now we're running out of little time here. So I'm gonna do some rapid fire questions and hopefully get a lot more of these cleared up. Sorry, there's a lot of questions. Oh, this one regarding options. It's from Monique Ramirez. For a project based on an event in history, do I have the option or right for that, Toni? If it's based on something in history that was an article?
So that's a tricky one, right? So it depends on how much you're going to lift from that article and that article alone. So if it's a historical event and say I read about a historical figure in a New York Times article and I go out and I do my own research on that historical figure and I write my screenplay based on my research, then no, I don't need to option that article. I don't need to do anything with that writer. But if I start lifting, like say, quotes from that article and using it as dialogue, yeah, you're going to probably run into a problem from the writer of that article. Or at the very least, especially for a historical piece, when you sell it, you're going to have to create like a essentially chain of title.
Yes.
The writers can tell me exactly what it's called. I always forget the freaking exact term, but you're going to have to essentially show your work, right? If you're writing a piece about a real life person, you're going to have to show, well, where did you get this information? Where did you get that? Yeah, it's almost like you're going to have to annotate your screenplay so that you can demonstrate where the information came from. And a lot of these requirements are based, you know, from people like myself who've sued on behalf of writers or someone who thought their information was stolen. And so in order to get insurance coverage for these projects, the insurers require a lot of paperwork because they want to make sure that they don't, that you have a paper trail for what you're writing. Now, if I want to go back and write about, the pharaohs of Egypt, right? These guys have been dead for a little bit. So that's in the public domain. Information about them is what, if you find information that's in the public domain, then it's a free for all. If I want to base my screenplay on a book written about the pharaohs, that's a completely different animal, and I have to get the rights from the author of that book. And let's say we want to take someone more recent. Let's say I want to write a piece about a politician or what have you, and I do my research and I'm writing about people who are still alive. Then you're going to run into an issue because it depends on how you present those people and yep. what you say about them and whether or not what you're saying is true and can be verified. And whether or not they are public figures. So there's a whole bunch of legal analysis that goes into that. It's not, a black and white, question. It's not that simple. But yeah, if they're not a non-public person, you should ideally have their permission or at the very least change enough in your story that they're not easily recognizable.
Yes.
People are saying, oh, what about the crown? What about the crown? Well, the crown is, those are public figures.
Yep.
Queen Elizabeth isn't, Queen Elizabeth is Queen Elizabeth. She's not Elizabeth Smith down the street. And you're going to write about, her affair with the butler and her drug use. And so you're painting her in a negative light that no one knew. And so she can sue you for defamation. And here's the thing, people get confused about it. It's like, well, if it's true, it's fine, right? Well, yes, but truth is a defense to a claim mm-hmm. of defamation. And that defense only gets heard after you get sued. So the goal is to always avoid getting sued. Okay, let's make that very clear. Avoid getting sued.
That's the whole entertainment industry wrapped up right there by Toni. Avoid getting sued. That's it.
If you take anything away from this panel, it's avoid getting sued.
Avoid getting sued, yes.
I want to ask Anna this question, but first I want to answer this question from Mary Provost, because I want to make this clear because Toni did mention this earlier. How did the author of Gone Girl get a contract that let her write the screenplay, something she's never done before? Because when that book came out, Mary, she had everyone in this city.
Everybody wanted that book.
She could do it, and she had a great agent at CAA. She could do whatever she wanted. I think the rights of that book sold for $1 million, which was not heard of for a woman female novelist at that time. So yeah, she got to do whatever she wanted, Jillian, because she had the book that people wanted. And same thing with J.K. Rowling, never written a screenplay, but she wrote
Fantastic Beasts.
Yeah, Fantastic Beasts. Because she's J.K. Rowling, she could, at the time, do whatever she wanted. So Mark, can you take us through really quick, because we talked about options and we talked about shopping, but the one agreement that we didn't talk about, which is so frustrating for me, is the development agreement and what that actually means.
The development agreement kind of, it goes hand in hand with the option agreement, because the option agreement pours into the development agreement. You'll find a lot of language in the option agreement that tells you a lot with the timeframes on what's going to happen, that once you're done with the screenplay and that you go into development. And basically what it is that option agreement kind of overpools that development timeframe with the fact that, for example, we had an 18-month agreement. And during that 18-month period, we worked with the development executive who took us into development on that screenplay. And you'll have to excuse, Anna's chasing a bunny right now. So this is like comic hour here in our household. So, yeah, so sorry for that interruption. That was kind of weird.
She's stomping her foot in the background. So I was trying to get her, but.
but anyway, yeah, the Benny Hill song should have played during that time frame. But that development agreement is really within that option time period, because once you develop it and it gets to that final draft, the option agreement is either going to be over and you go into another period of that option agreement, which turns now in that option language, it'll say, you developed this project with us. Now we're going to take it to Netflix. Now we're going to shop it around. Now we're going to do this. So for 12 more months, you're still not allowed to do anything with it.
Oh,
and then if
so
they can't
annoying.
Get anyone to, let's say they're not a big production company who's actually going to make the film, but they're a sister production company who's going to partner with someone else. If they can't find someone else to partner with, because it happens, then all those rights revert back to you. But that language has to say that in the option agreement, that once this option agreement is done and the development agreement is done, you all the rights revert back to you. And you actually get to take that developed product that you had, that's a much more better story, and then turn it into something
new. If they develop it. So my cautionary advice is be very cautious with development agreements, because you could be in a black pit hole for months.
Yes.
Doing nothing but rewriting and rewriting and rewriting for free. And it's so annoying.
Yes.
You have to make sure that you're getting paid for rewrites.
Yeah.
That's one of the very most important things, because trust me, they will try their darndest to make sure. They'll say, we're giving you this amount, but the language never talks about rewrites. And then you're in the, like Sade said, you're in this 20 rewrite hellhole, and you're like, you're doing all this time and money that you could have made. So always make sure you get paid for rewrites. Why? A lawyer should always look it over.
Yes. Toni, this is from Jeffrey Knight. Toni, when do things, people, et cetera, come into public domain? Is it 50 years?
Oh gosh, I have an IP attorney for these questions, because I don't. That requires math in my mind. Does not like doing math.
There is a website though you could go to as well.
You can check on the Library of Congress website, which controls copyrights, but it's the life of the author plus a certain number of years. So it's a significant amount of time before work goes into the public domain. So this is why a lot of works are based on Shakespeare.
Yeah.
There are tons of screenplays based on Shakespeare's works, you know, from, you know, Clueless all the way to things
all
that are just named.
Classics.
Yeah. Yeah.
I do believe, don't quote me, but I believe someone, if either of you know this, that Great Gatsby just went into public domain. I believe. I don't quote me, but I think it did. If it did, have fun doing all your spin-off and adaptations on the Great Gatsby.
Yeah. Exactly. Anything in the public domain you can is up for grabs. So take a look at your classic literature and realize that a lot of the things that we are seeing are stories that we love are based on a lot of classic literature that's been in the public domain for hundreds of years. It's all of Shakespeare's stuff and you know, you name it, the Three Musketeers, all that stuff. People love reworking those things.
Anna, this question is from Scott Curtis. He wants to know, what about a writer coming on as a consultant, or one thing we haven't talked about, there's consulting, right? There's polishing. There's script doctoring. Like, do you have any experience in what that looks like when you're not the original writer on something and you have to jump in and make a fix?
Yeah,
we've fixed several people's scripts.
The good thing about that is, you know, it's basically, it depends on the contract.
Right.
And you can jump in and fix a script, but it's a one-time fee. So say they bring Anna in for, she needs to fix my script. She's going to get paid a one-time fee, whatever she needs to do.
Right. And depending on how much work you do, you might not get writing credit, or you might get a different credit or something like that. But
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
We're in our last 10 minutes here, so we're going to start doing some more rapid fire. So this is your chance, you guys. Shoot all your questions. I'm just going to go down the line. This is interesting. Actually, Toni, this is a question. I can't find who asked it, but it's in here. There's been a lot of talk about the HBO Max agreement right now, of what's happening and how that affects the waterfall of for feature films. Can you explain what if you know what the waterfall is and all when it comes to back end points and all that stuff when we're talking about features? Okay.
So basically, with back end is contemplating profits made after all the expenses and costs of making the film are recouped. So it makes more sense to have a back end deal when there's potential for theatrical. For streaming services, back-end deals are, well, they will tell you they're difficult to do, or and they don't really do them, but I think there's a way to get it done. It's just a matter of people coming together and thinking about it and wanting to get it done. I mean, I'm like, we put a person on the moon. You're telling me we can't fucking figure out back-end from a streaming service deal? I'm sorry. I don't know if I can curse, but... Look, after a while it just becomes so insane that I'm like, this is driving me insane. So back end and the waterfall. Oh God, the waterfall is basically how funds flow once profits are made on a film, or how the money will flow at that point. How to explain that? So the HBO Max deal, if it's the one that I'm thinking of,
well, now they're gonna have their movies for 2021 premiere in a theater and on the platform at the same day.
At the same time. So this is pissing off everyone. major filmmakers because of the deals that they did. Yeah. And the reason filmmakers are pissed is because the deals they did not contemplate this as a distribution strategy.
Oh yeah.
And it wasn't communicated. Yeah.
Yeah. And also, yes, and also HBO decided to do it in a really shitty way by, instead of announcing to the people they'd done deals with, hey guys, this is how we're going to do this, they instead basically put out a
blast,
you know, a press release to that effect. And that's how these filmmakers who trusted them with their content found out. Will there be lawsuits? Probably. There are going to be a lot of really heated discussions about this. I'm not exactly, because I'm not privy to the deals, I haven't seen what the filmmakers actually agreed to. I have no idea how that's going to turn out. But what it does for people like myself and agents and managers, it makes us very wary. And it makes us spend a lot more time pouring through contracts with a fine tooth comb than we already do. I'm working on a contract, and the person on the other side basically said, well, we thought we had the rights to do XYZ based on this very general language. And I just started laughing. And I said, well, as a former litigator, I would argue that you do not. I really need you to hear what I'm saying. As a former litigator, I don't think you have the rights that you think you do. And the what I would point to is the fact that you've now come to me with very explicit language to get those rights. So if you thought you already had them, then you wouldn't have sent me a revised contract with very explicit language in it. So it's that particular situation has rankled a lot of feathers. It remains to be seen how it's going to shake out, because it's so new.
We'll see.
But I can tell you right now, people are pissed. And some major filmmakers who really make moves in this town, who people, you know, you always take their calls. They are incensed. So there's going to be some significant fallout.
It's important, everyone watching this panel, you go to the trades, read the articles. Yeah. You need to know how this business, because this is a business, runs. You need to understand what a waterfall is. You understand how money is made from movies and TVs and ads and placements. So you know where you fit in this ecosystem, okay?
And there are tons of books out there, by the way. Amazon is your friend in terms of finding, and Google. There are tons of books now about the business of the entertainment industry. So there really is no excuse for someone to say, well, I don't know. Spend 2 or 3 hours on Google reading stuff.
Peter R wants to ask, Anna and Mark, is your lip management company local on the East Coast or is it in LA, or are you bi-coastal? How do you do that?
Yeah, so we live in New York, and then our manager is in LA.
Yep.
Wow.
Well, he's in Pennsylvania right now because of
COVID. He's in Pennsylvania, but yeah, see, he's actually based. He's prior WME. So he's actually based in Los Angeles. So you don't need a lit manager or agent or anyone that's in your demographic area, or, you know, or any geographical location, sorry. But yeah, anywhere will work.
Same question, for you, Anna, I'm pointing this question, sorry. Cam Crane, what is the importance of having multiple scripts available for the marketplace?
1,000%. Do not go to the market with one screenplay.
Okay, so I have a story.
Quick story.
But I'm trying to be quick. So I went to UCLA 2005. I graduated 2006. It was their master's level program. And I had two scripts, and one is garbage and you will never see it. And the other one I thought was pretty good. And I got it to a producer friend who had helped us produce the feature that I had filmed in 2005. And they optioned it. And they said, you know, we went right into development and we were going to film it and we started casting it. And I had a no dollar option. Look at all the red flags, right? I had a no dollar option. And then I was supposed to be paid the first day of principal photography. So I did tons of rewrites, 4 or 5 or 6 rewrites. And then the director came on and she did rewrites. And we were getting ready to shoot. We were just weeks away from principal photography. All the actors were attached, all of this stuff, and everything was great. And we had so much momentum. And then a similar movie with George Clooney came out, and it hadn't even really come out. They just like announced it and they put out the trailer for it. And it was close enough that the production company said no, and we're done, and they dropped it. So I worked for 6 months for free. I never got paid for it. And all I had was a great writing sample. And so the director took it to every place. She took it to Paramount, all the big studios. And they said, it's a great writing sample. What else does she have? And the answer was nothing.
So you got to be very careful with that, because
I shot myself in the foot.
Once you have a good project, they want to know what else you have. And if you don't have a portfolio of work to go to the industry with, you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot, because you can't put all your stuff in all the fires. This industry, because I think Toni has mentioned it before and Sade has mentioned it, you hurry up and you wait. Well, what are you doing during that time that you're waiting? You can put another screenplay out and put this screenplay out and put this screenplay out. So that's why it's important to have more than one project.
Man, Mark, you didn't have to hit us so hard.
Can I piggyback off of that as well? What they're saying is absolutely true. And I have this conversation with writer clients all the time, or people who contact me to represent them as writers. The first thing I ask is, what else do you have? And if the answer is, I don't have anything else. And I was like, I can't represent you, because it would be a waste of your time and mine. If I happen to get you in a room, the next question is going to be, after they take a look at what you're submitting, is what else do you have? And if the answer is nothing, well, we've just wasted time. And here's the reason for that also. Someone can write a really good script the first time just out of luck, out of sheer luck. They can put together a good screenplay. We know you're a good writer if you can do it 2, 3, 4, 10 times. So we want to see that you are actually serious about writing. and that you are actually a good writer. Because if we get you in a writer's room for a series, or if we get your screenplay sold and you need to do a rewrite and a polish, we need to know that you can actually do it. It's a waste of time and money if you can't. So if you're going to be a writer, keep writing. That's what makes you a writer, writing.
100%.
Yeah, you're an investment.
I'm feeling personally attacked today.
I know you're a good writer, so I don't even.
You better start writing after this is done. I want to see it.
Actually, I blocked my day out to finish writing. So, but for Toni to continue, Steve Driffin did ask this question. So you did say he wants to know what interests you in taking new clients. So we already know one is how much they're writing, but is there any other aspects about that you consider?
You know, I like clients who are hustlers. You know, I don't want a client who's like, hey, here's my stuff. And then they're just going to sit on their butt and, you know, expect the world to come to them. Oh. This is a business and you have to understand the business. You know, the kind of starving artist or the artist who doesn't really understand the industry that they're trying to break into, we should not be there anymore. There's just way too much information at your fingertips. This is a freaking computer. I can find out anything at the touch of a few buttons. So there's just no excuse anymore. When I was in my teens and 20s and I wanted to learn about screenwriting and being a film producer, you know what I had to do? I had to freaking trek to the public library and look through card files, because they didn't even have computers, and look through these card files and find books and then go find them on the shelf and hope the librarian had put them in the place that they were supposed to be. I mean, it's back in the olden days, guys, before we had had electricity. You know what I'm saying?
You're not that. Stop it.
But no, I mean, you really want a client who is passionate about their writing, but also knows that no script is perfect. I'm always weary when someone tells me, oh, I have the perfect script. It's great. It's the best thing you'll ever read. Yep. It's perfect, blah, 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 blah. Because I already know it's going to be a piece of shit. I'm sorry. I just do. I've had enough 100%. Experience.
Yeah.
When someone comes to me with that, like, this is the best thing you'll ever read? Like, seriously? Do you know how much I've read?
It's never the best thing. It never is.
It's almost always the worst thing I've ever read.
Very attacked.
Our first drafts are never the best first draft ever. No.
Very attacked today.
I'm going to tell you guys right now, Sade is a great writer. So, and she's extremely talented. So she knows what she's talking about. But yeah, if you are, the best clients are the people who get their work done. And an agent will tell you this, and a manager will tell you this. Know your craft. Don't think that you can do this part-time or in your free time, like 5 minutes a day. There are people who spend 10 to 12 hours a day writing. And if you think you're going to outwrite them, it's the same way with someone thinking that they were going to out-hustle Kobe Bryant. He's one of the best basketball players and spent time, like serious time, practicing. And so that's how you get great. Is through
this is not a part-time job by any means.
Not if you want to make a career out of it.
Right.
And there's nothing wrong with people who are hobbyists, who do it for fun and it's great. And you know, this is what I do in my spare time and I'm writing a screenplay and it takes me 3 years. If that's good for you and that's fun for you, that's great. But it's going to be really hard to make a career out of it if you're only putting out a screenplay every 3 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Again. So attacked. No, it's a pandemic. I took a break.
Yeah, but you've been writing long before that and you have stuff in the queue. Yes, so I'm not worried about you.
This is true. About 10 more minutes left here. Jessica Todman, please answer in all caps. I'm answering, Jessica.
Uh-oh, all caps.
What's the minimum amount of work script should a new writer have coming to the market? I think they just answered that. There's no minimum. You just need all.
You need work. You need work.
Two?
I mean, right, exactly. You need at least two. At least
Yeah, you need at least two. Yes. For us, we had, when we started hitting the market hard, we had almost 10. But that worked for us. You know, it doesn't say you have to do 10. It just said what we did is we did multiple genres. So we had a couple of screenplays in each genre that we could push.
A couple of horror, a couple of comedies, and, you know, and it helps you figure out what kind of writer you are.
Yeah.
Like, I never thought I would be a horror writer until someone said, oh, could you write a horror movie?
And then it was one of our first feature films. So here we are.
So
never discount the fact of trying multiple genres to see where you can actually land your expertise in.
Caroline Sachs, Toni is a lawyer. If anyone joining us late in the game, if you're just joining us, Toni Long is our attorney, offering her experience and advice. She is not advising you. This is her experience and her advice. You cannot say my attorney, Toni. No, don't do that. Okay, so we're gonna go do and just open it up to the floor because we answered, we answered a lot of money questions and everything. So now I just wanna get into some fun stuff before we have to head out for the day. And of course, if you've missed any part of this, you joined us late, this will be on the YouTube channel for Final Draft, I believe in like a week or so. So don't worry about that. Mark and Anna, how does one get credit to join the WGA? There's a lot of ways.
Okay, the biggest way, Google, like Toni said, it's all on this super lovely computer. If you go to wj.org, they actually have the minimum requirements that it takes to actually go ahead and get into the guild. And there's two different types of requirements. One is for the WJ East, one is for the WJ West, which is surprising. I don't know why they have different requirements, but they do. The WJ West really requires a lot of a point system that they have it based on, whether it's writing for a television show and so much for a distributed, you know, short film and so much for this criteria, that criteria, where the WJ East is more lax a little bit. And they say, well, is it a guild contract with a guild company? There are multiple ways to get in. But like I said, you have to look in the WJ requirements online, and they spell it out perfectly there.
We are not guild, by the way.
We're not guild.
Like I said, I've had a lot of success non-union, but nothing hurts more when you're like, oh, I wrote a movie, it came out on TV, I get to join the union. No, because the company's non-union and you need to do a signatory.
They're not a signatory.
The company has to be signatory for it to be a guild contract.
Yes.
And you could try to convince the company, I failed, to join the signatory. And then you could be back in credited and get your WGA, but if they don't do it, you can't. So
yeah, and look, there's a lot of writers, successful writers through their whole career, who never stepped foot in the WGA.
Yeah, never joined the union.
And our first big four deals are all right now non-WGA at the moment.
Yeah, it's possible. Toni, Eugene Bastis, I think that's how you pronounce it. Why sell the IP? Why not just do long-term leases and royalty agreements?
Well, that's going to depend on who wants the IP and whether or not they're willing to do that. And so if I'm going to, as a writer, you wrote a screenplay and I want to make a film, a licensing agreement is not the way to go for me. It's going to, if I'm the producer, it's going to severely limit what I can do with that project. So at the end of the day, you as a writer can try and get someone to do it that way. The likelihood of you being successful.
Disney won't.
yeah, Disney, Warner Brothers, Sony, Universal, they will not do that. And neither will most independent producers who are going to take your project to any of those studios or streaming services. They're going to want to option it, and they're going to want, because they want the product or the project for as long as they can get it so that they can exploit it in as many different ways as they possibly can. That's how they make money. And ultimately, that's how you make money. And they're in a better position to exploit your IP than you are because of the connections they have. And that's just simply how it's done.
And we may do a whole different panel. I'm putting this in your ear now, Final Draft, just about IP, intellectual property, if you don't know what that means. because when everyone screams online, why aren't they making new things? Why aren't they investing in originals? That's when I know you don't understand how IP works. And I can get into that, but we're going to do a whole panel on it later probably because it is important to know. Anna, Kasi Por Mukhtar. Sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong. I sincerely apologize. What if the option agreement and shopping agreement results in no one buying it? Does the writer keep the money from the shopping or option agreement, or does all the money have to go back?
Yeah, no, it's a paycheck. Yeah. So you get paid. So yeah, and then you just have to make sure that your contract says that once that option agreement is done, if it doesn't sell, that you get all the rights back. That's the most important thing.
Yep.
Yeah. Reversion of rights provision is very important. And also making sure that there is no language, no one's inserted any language that says they get their money back if the project doesn't
sell. Yeah.
I would not be surprised if someone trying to sneak that one in there.
Oh, yeah. God, yeah. But, you know, but hey.
We've personally never seen that. So.
Yeah, I've never seen it.
But to that point, from personal experience, when you are entering competitions, everyone, even if you don't win, like I was a finalist for a competition, I didn't win. They technically, there was an option agreement embedded in my agreement. I believe it's 3 years. So, but it's up to you to go back and remind that network, that company that you want your, like, I mean, they should automatically revert back, but it's up to you to go back and check your contract to say, do I get my rights back now? Because it took me like 5 years to realize, oh yeah, they never did anything with my project. So I want my script back. Right. So you have to take care of that on your own.
Right. When my project fell through and they said, we're not going to do it because of the George Clooney movie that just came out. I had to get it in writing that they were saying, we're not going to do anything with it. You're mm-hmm. part of this fulfilled yeah. and you have all your rights back.
Yeah.
Yes. Toni, only a couple more questions here, you guys. So I'm trying to get through them, but Jack Sojica, once your script is optioned, can the option holder make changes to your script?
Yeah. I mean, it depends on what's in the option agreement. Certainly once they exercise the option, they can, because at that point they would own it. But it depends on what's in the option agreement. I'll see certain language in shopping agreements or during the development phase of an option agreement where it says that if they need to make changes in order to get it sold, yes. So it's really going to depend on what you negotiate in the agreement.
Mark and Anna, Robel Nugaisi says, me and my twin brother love writing together. I think you're pursuing a career in screenwriting together. Do you have any tips for navigating a collaborative writing career? Do you guys write together?
Yes. Yes, okay. We do. 100% when it comes to collaboration. And this doesn't just mean writing partners. This means when you actually get staffed on a project, when you actually have more than one writer on any project, 100% communication is the key. We also have to remove your ego out of the picture. You have to remove your mentality of don't change my work. That's my idea. I love that idea. You have to be open and understand that everything you and your partner do is to better the story, not to take one's contribution away from the actual project, but to make sure that the story itself is getting better and better and better. So always start out with that mind frame. Communication, always make the story better and go with that mindset together at the same time.
And with us working together, it helps us build, we do a lot of pre-writing because we are a team. So we can make sure that the story that I put on the page in this scene is the story that he had in his head. So we do the treatment, the outline, the synopsis, all of that stuff to make sure that before anybody starts with fade in, that we know what we're going to do as a team, because otherwise it's just going to lead to, like Mark said, you know, communication breakdowns later on.
Yep.
All right. And this is the last question. I said I wasn't going to answer it here, but I think it's just a good wrap up for everyone. But again, we did answer this question in previous panels that you can find on the YouTube page. I'm going to start with myself, then Toni, then Mark, then Anna to wrap us up. Should you copyright and WJ register your script? The one thing I will say is do whatever you feel, on my opinion, that protects your script, but you can't copyright an idea. You actually have to have something written. So if you're thinking I can just copyright my idea, that's crazy. Toni?
Yeah, so I agree with Sade. Yes, a script can be registered for copyright. Technically speaking, once something is affixed to a tangible medium, it is protected by copyright. So for example, this
law,
yes, in US, for the US law. So for example, this is being recorded. So everything we're saying here is technically protected by copyright. Now, if the rights holder wants to enforce those rights, it's best to then register it with the US, with the Library of Congress. You cannot, after you've, maybe someone has infringed, you can't then go register with the Copyright Office and then expect to get the same rights for damages and what have you. The the benefit of registering it with the Copyright Office is it gives you more rights when it comes time to enforce any kind of copyright infringement. That's really the benefit of that. And it's worth the $25 or whatever you're gonna pay to do it, because you can get treble damages or something like that, or attorney's fees. So attorneys like that. That's one of the first things I always ask if someone comes to me with an infringement case, like, is it registered with the Copyright Office? Yes.
Great. Mark?
And on that final note, to piggyback off Toni, not only is the copyright very important, but again, this is a business, this is an industry. You are a marketable tool for that industry. Also think of it in the long run as far as contracts go. When they buy your screenplay, when they buy your product, you realize that they also have to purchase the copyright in that contract. And a lot of time, that's a separate fee. So that's a compounded separate fee on top of that to purchase that. And I know a lot of people are like, well, I also do WJ registration. If you're not in the WJ registration, only thing that does, it can show in a chain of custody of when you did the treatment, when you did the actual, you know, script and all that. But honestly, the copyright is the legal horsepower of the whole thing.
Anna?
Okay, well, you guys all said everything.
Just go ditto.
Ditto. But Mark's right. You know, when you do sign your contract, they're not going to ask you what the WGA number is. They're going to ask you what the copyright number is. So we always copyright, and we sometimes do WGA.
Yeah. So, and then, and if you want to do WGA because you feel like it's extra layers, you do not have to be in the WGA to do it. You go to their website. Just remember, if you're on the East Coast, do the East. If you're on the West, I think it's all the same, but you can do it. The last note I want to end with, and then I want to get everyone's contact information if you want to say it to the people where they can find you, is, and we'll talk about this in another panel, chill out on sending the NDAs, y'all. Trust me, if you got the if you got the copyright to your script, you don't need to send the NDA to the producer.
Yeah. I don't know anyone who will sign them. I've actually had clients or potential clients ask me if I would sign an NDA, and I'm like, you're my client. I'm bound by the rules of professional conduct to keep your shits confidential unless you tell me not to.
All over the internet.
Yeah, it's like every time I see someone and here's NDA, I'm calm down, sir.
You do not need an NDA if you copyright. You are legally protected. You're fine.
You're good. Okay. So this has been so amazing. We had 1,200 people join us today.
Oh,
and
wow.
1,000 people in here from all over the world. And this ends our panel. We hope we ended your year off in a good note. We hope we inspired you to go and write. I know I am, because I'm sick of being called out by Mark and Anna and Toni. They're subbing me all conversation. if you'd like to share where the people can find you online, please do. Toni.
Sure. So my website is tyllaw.com. That's our law firm. There's a contact form there. If you want to schedule a consultation, you can do so that way. If you check out my bio, my email is there. Pretty easily accessible as an attorney. It's easy to find attorneys.
Yeah. Mark and Anna?
We are both on Twitter and Instagram. So our handles are Mark Literally and Anna Literally. The same on Instagram as well, except hers has an IG at the end of it. And our production company that you'll see come up shortly too is Roddy Rabbit Films.
Oh, the rabbits are back. and then I am putting it in the chat box. You can grab it right now, but I am on Twitter at I am Sade Sellers, S-A-D-E. I'm very active on there. So you can come say hello. I won't read your scripts. I'm just letting you know that right now. I don't want to. It's just because I really am really bad with my own time that I can't.
We don't have time, unfortunately.
I don't have time to read scripts.
But we would all love to just say hello. Hey, Belize. Hey, absolutely. I love saying hi to people from Belize because I'm from Belize. My mom's from Belize. So we'd love to say hello and talk to you. And if you have any follow-up questions, I would love to answer those, but I'm not reading scripts, you guys.
Our DMs are open. We are on Twitter. Yeah. So people can feel free to ask us a question, an industry question or anything. And we'll just tell you our experience and what we've learned so far.
Absolutely. Oh my gosh, you guys, we did it. Thank you so much. This was amazing. Oh,
thank you guys. This is fantastic.
And we post a lot of bunny pics. A lot of people love our bunny pics. And thank you for the people. I saw it when we brought the bunny out. Someone said snowflake. So whoever that was, thank you.
Your bunny is famous. I love it.
He is famous.
They all are.
We want to thank everyone at Final Draft. They offered this platform for us. They're letting us do this to cater to you guys.
Thank you, Final Draft.
Hopefully, if you like this, please go tell Final Draft that you liked it, because we'd like to do more in 2021. Toni, Mark, Anna, you guys have been amazing. I love you.
You too. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having us.
Happy holidays. Stay COVID safe and healthy, wealthy, and wise. And I'll see you guys in Twitter, or I'll see you, Toni, next week, and I'll see everyone else on Twitter.
Toni, it's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you guys.
Talking to you again.
Yeah, same here. Thank you, Final Draft. Thank you, everybody, for participating. Thanks, Sade.
Thanks for having us.
Everyone, happy holidays.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays.